Hello, everyone. Welcome to UFO Planet. I'm Darren Crapo. On today's episode, we will be visiting Washington State, the city of Los Angeles, and Germany. We will also be joined by Milton Finch, who captured last evening, April 9th, an absolutely fascinating UFO sighting over St. Stephen, South Carolina. Plus, at the end of the program, we'll be joined by Costa McCreese from etletstalk.org. Our journey into the unknown gets started right now. Welcome to today's program. I appreciate each and every one of you tuning in today, and I have some fascinating footage to show you and some awesome interviews. We're going to start our journey into the unknown today by heading off first to Yakult, Washington State. We're going to take a look at a video shot on April 6th by Heather Ruff of a white object passing through the clouds. Let's get this clip rolling. Heather, many of you will remember, was the very first guest that I ever had on UFO Planet, and she's still looking up into the sky. And wow, did she capture something fascinating. Not a very long video, so we're gonna have to run through it here a few times and slow it down into slow motion. But you can definitely see bottom right-hand corner of your screen there. Do you suppose that looks like an airplane there? You can kind of see something on the left-hand side, or the right-hand side, I guess it would be, of this object. But you don't really get a really close, accurate look at it. But when you see it at the best you can, it doesn't really look like an airplane. Absolutely amazing. Something up in the sky over Yakult, Washington, no doubt about it. Now we're going to head to Frankfurt, Germany. This is an absolutely amazing video shot by Peter Believer. Awesome nickname, I love that. Shot on March 28th. It's just what I call a sky full of objects. Here we go with this one. The first object, rather massive in size. We do see some flashing aviation lights on this, but let's just take a look and see what we're looking at here. We have a couple of, looks like headlights in the front. We have a red light and a flashing white light on the back side of it. Compare that to the ground. You can actually see the trees below this object there. It's not moving. It's not a high-speed aircraft in any stretch of the imagination. It almost seems like it's hovering. Lots of action here. We're going to see a lot more lights coming up right away here as well. Beautiful video shot in Germany. Peter Believer. Like I said before, that's an awesome nickname. Obviously, Peter believes. And he should. There's lots to see out there and lots of videos coming our way. This is about a 4-minute clip, but trust me, it's worth every minute of it. Now get a load of this. Take a look at these lights. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at least. Look to be very bright. I don't think those are stars. They're way too bright for that. And You know, they kind of have the look of a Chinese lantern, but I'm pretty sure that they're not Chinese lanterns, at least in this instance. Peter's going to speed things up now. This entire video was edited by Peter. Excellent job. Had some of his own music in the background. Unfortunately, we have to remove that to use the video on YouTube. Take a look at the flashing lights that we saw on that one object that was falling close to the ground there. It looks like they're coming in for a landing. So, meanwhile, in the trees, this is what landed. Absolutely amazing footage here. It's too bad he couldn't get a little bit closer into those trees and see what was actually there. It would have been amazing to see that close up. You can see some flashing lights and whatnot coming off of the object that has landed in the trees. Absolutely amazing, isn't it? Kind of looks like there's some different colors on those lights. From time to time, it looks a little bit bluish and a little bit red, and then bright white. Peter, if you ever get that close again, mosey on through those trees and see what you can snap inside them. See if you can capture the object. Unfortunately, this happened at night. Seems to be when most of the action happens around the world, isn't it? We get about 20 night vision videos for every one daytime UFO video that we get sent into UFO Planet here. So nighttime is definitely the most popular, probably because it's easier to see objects up in the sky at night, whereas in the daytime, the brightness of the sky kind of makes those objects not that easy to see. Next, we're going to go to East Los Angeles in California. We're going to take a look at a video that was recorded on March 28th by Jonathan Castro. He calls this an Ebony UFO. I'm not familiar with Ebony UFOs, but Jonathan obviously is, and here's what he saw.
What?
Look.
Okay, what?
Look.
What, baby?
Just look.
I'm filming something right now, baby.
I want a baby and a brother.
A baby, a little baby brother?
No, a baby and a brother.
Hold on. Okay. Let me film something, yeah?
Yeah, sure.
This is an Ebony. This is a white Ebony.
Beat.
You hear me, yes. Jaylee?
Yes.
I have a white Ebony in.
Hey, yes,
that's pretty cool.
Let me show you something.
Next to the moon.
It's falling.
Jaylee.
Yeah.
You please don't move me.
I'm not.
All right. Zoom out here, watch it next to the moon. I'm zooming in. Here's white, a lot of energy to it. Very high up there. I'm a full 80 optical zoom.
Absolutely fascinating, Jonathan. That was a great capture. Now, some of you are going to remember that that looks a lot like the UFOs that are being captured in the summons events that are held in Los Angeles, California. And like I said, I know very little about that, so I'm going to find out. And I've asked Robert Bingham to be a guest on the program next week, a week from today, and he's going to explain to us what exactly goes on at these events, and I have some questions for him, so make sure you tune in 1 week from today. It's time now to take a look and see what my awesome, wonderful, fantastic, every other wonderful word I can think of viewers had to say on the last episode of UFO Planet.
Priority one message from Starfleet coming in on secured channel.
Well, thank you very much for each and every one of you who post comments on UFO Planet. I really appreciate the participation. I'd just like to take a moment and welcome all the new viewers to UFO Planet. There's new subscribers virtually every day, and I just want to say welcome to the UFO Planet family. UFO Planet is a program where you can see the latest happenings in the UFO world without the fear of having to deal with bullies and trolls. For you to see TV is a bully and troll free zone. We have a zero tolerance policy. So go ahead and post your comments. We'd love to see what you have to say about what you see on the program. Now it's time to take a look in outer space. And I promise you guys, what you're about to see isn't going to make you happy. At least it didn't me. Take a look at this. On April 3rd, they had to actually move the space station out of the way so it wouldn't be hit by debris that came within 1,000 feet of the station. Now that's pretty close when you're in outer space. The debris field was created by parts of an old Ariane 5 rocket launched by the European Space Agency. Now the Europeans aren't the only ones littering space. The Americans, Canadians, and everyone are at it too. There's an estimated 370,000 pieces of space junk floating in Earth's orbit, traveling at speeds of up to 22,000 miles an hour. I just want to mention as well that over 20,000 of those pieces of space junk are large enough to be tracked from Earth. So they had to move the space station out of the way to avoid getting hit. But you take a look at this, well, video of the junk that is floating around our Earth that we, mankind, has put out there, and it's absolutely disgusting to look at, isn't it? I think they need to institute a new rule. If you take it up, it's your responsibility to bring it down. I don't think the European Space Agency or NASA have the right to cause this much pollution around our planet. Can you imagine someone in a spacecraft trying to come to Earth? You'd be lucky if you can make it without getting whacked. Of course, you know, when you get into outer space, these objects aren't all in one spot. They're all over the place around the Earth. But I think it's just really a bad stain on the history of mankind that we have polluted space so much, as well as our Earth. But that's another topic for another day. Now we're going to move on to an absolutely fascinating video sighting that took place just last evening in St. Stephen, South Carolina. I got a Skype from Milton Finch and a few emails alerting me to the fact that he had captured something fantastic. I said to him, Milton, I already have the program created for Thursday, but it's going to have to change because you need to be on there. Here is the video and our short interview about the video. We're back in St. Stephen, South Carolina with Milton Finch. Milton, welcome to the program today.
It's great to be here again, Darren.
Well, Milton, I had a couple of Skype calls from you yesterday that I missed, and then eventually we connected up, and it turns out you've one-upped yourself from your last sighting and captured another sighting that is absolutely fascinating.
It was a surprise to get it. Audrey and I, we were out. I have a program called Sputnik, which is an app that lets you know whenever an Iridium satellite or the ISS space station is going over. And we were out there looking at the ISS space station coming in from the west, and all of a sudden a little orange light appears over there to the right, which would be to our east. And we started looking at that, and Audrey went running for the camera at that point.
She's a good woman to do that. So just let me understand this correctly. You were actually planning to look at the ISS pass overhead, and that's why you had gone outside. And then when did you also see the ISS at this time?
Yes, we saw both of them in the sky at the same time.
Excellent. So you can confirm that there's no relationship between what we're about to see and the ISS.
Right. The ISS was going, in our view, from left to right, and whatever this thing is that we saw was going in circles.
Okay. Now, what I've done is I've asked you to cue up your video and be prepared to describe to us exactly what we're seeing, because you can give us colors and sizes and that based on your personal experience. So could you go ahead now and just tell us what we're looking at here on the screen?
Okay. I'm starting at about the 1:10 of the video right now. And I'm homing in on the orange object, and I'm focusing in on it. And then all of a sudden, I start noticing two small, little, very faint little blips next to it at about the 5 o'clock level. If you were looking at a clock, the face of a clock, about 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And then it seems to be moving. At first, I think it's a triangle that I'm seeing, but it morphs as it goes because of the position of the objects that we're looking at. Now it's gone to three at this point that are tagging along with whatever the big thing is, which is orange.
Yeah, there's one much larger object there that you're seeing, and smaller objects that seem to be almost either coming out of it or circling around it, going in behind it. What do you think that looks like to you?
I'm thinking they're escorting it. Before I started filming, I was seeing some flashing lights like military jets near it, but none of these are flashing at this point. I don't know what's going on here. We're coming up to a telephone pole. It goes behind the telephone pole, and there it comes out. And now the one in the rear drops. This is not a flare. This is one of the military.
Yeah, you can clearly see that dropping.
Yes, it absolutely drops. I've been asked, is that a flare? No, that's one of the objects that was with it. And now it's going, basically to the east, which is, by the way, the direction that the ISS was going also.
Okay, but that's in a different part of the sky right now.
Oh, it's gone at this point. The ISS is
okay.
No longer in the sky or visible.
Okay.
But now it's basically doing a circle around again, and this would be going off towards the Myrtle Beach area, which is, as the crow flies, 60 miles from here, in that direction, wherever this is going. But yet this is not going in a straight line path. It's going around in a circle again.
So they're kind of staying in the same area, just doing like a circular flight pattern? Is that what you think?
Yes, it covered, oh gosh, it's hard to say. I would say probably 30% of the sky that's viewable, 20% of the sky in a big loop fashion.
Okay.
But it was so strange to see these lights get brighter and dimmer, and it was a neat sighting.
Now, I just want to ask you a little bit more about the larger of the objects. You were telling me on Skype last night that it was orange.
Yes, sir.
And
the large light is orange.
Did it seem like it was illuminated?
No, this looked like a manufactured orange light. When you mean illuminated, like, was it like a lamp that you would see, like a lava lamp or
right,
something?
Right, yeah, like a bright light coming out that different than just a solid craft.
Right, it looked like an orange light. Now, at this point, at the 4 minute 46 second, there's a military jet down below that was flashing.
And so you can tell that the difference in between the objects, like the larger object and the military jets that are flying in the area at the same time, and those are the smaller of the lights, correct?
Yes, sir. The one
that are flying away.
Right, it's not on screen anymore, but whatever, there is definitely two lights at the orange light level. You have the orange light and now one smaller one off to about the 10 o'clock level on a face of a clock. So you could probably blow that up and really see it well.
Yeah, I looked at it in full screen mode last night while we were talking about it, and it's at one point you see it looks like a smaller object on either side of the larger object too.
Yes, yes. There were, at one point it looked like three objects right around it.
And how long did it stay in the area, Milton?
Well, I went as long as I could. I got tired. I had my wife to hold it to try to get the camera. I'm losing it right here, and I'm handing off the camera to my wife. And she never does find it. She finds some military jets blinking, which we see right now, but she never homes in on the orange object. And I'm saying, no, you got to get the orange object, sweetheart. Real nice that way, you know.
I like that sweetheart part. That'll do a lot more work for you than other things.
And then I'll take it back momentarily because I got tired of holding it. And but I didn't last much longer. Maybe another 4 minutes. Now I've grabbed it and I've immediately put it onto the object again right there, where it's flying over a telephone pole.
So how long did this stay in the area? Any particular duration?
I had to come inside. It was still flying around when I came inside.
Wow.
So
your original video there that is on your YouTube channel, it's about 11 minutes roughly, isn't it? So
yep.
You have quite a bit of film there. And the viewers won't see all of it during this interview, so you definitely want to visit Milton on YouTube if you want to watch the entire raw video. It's pretty fascinating. Milton, I didn't think you'd be able to up the sighting you had last time there. I believe it was in January. But you've definitely done it here. You can see the larger object. You can see the smaller objects that are near to the largest object. But you can also see the military jets that are flying in the area. And if I remember correctly, you mentioned to me that you could definitely hear the military jets, correct?
Absolutely. Yeah, you can hear those. I'm not sure if I was hearing the orange light during that period because the military jets are so loud during that period. You know, I mean, they would drown out any sound if that happened
right
to it.
But there was no, obviously it wasn't louder than the jets, so if it wasn't making any noise, it was potentially being covered up.
Right.
By the sound coming from the jets.
Yes.
Well, that's absolutely fascinating. You make a good team, you and Audrey, there out catching these UFOs, and you have some really fascinating activity there, something that I've never seen in any submissions that I've had on the program in the past. Some people have sent in videos and said, hey, this looks a lot like Milton's, and then I put it on and it looks nothing like what you had captured previously, but this is absolutely fascinating. Are you going to keep looking?
Absolutely. I bought the equipment. I'm not going to let it get dusty.
Well, you're doing good at it. And well,
thank you.
I have two favorite videos in all the videos that I've done on UFO Planet, and you shot both of them. So excellent job. And
thank
you. Just want to thank you, Milton, for being on the program today and sharing with us, and remind the viewers to go check out your channel and take a look at your other videos as well in raw format.
Look it up on YouTube. It's Milton Finch. That's my channel.
Excellent. Thanks so much and have a good one.
Thank you, Darren. Take care.
Wasn't that just a totally fascinating sighting that Milton had down in St. Stephen, South Carolina? When we spoke on the phone last night, I could tell in the excitement in his voice that he was very pleased with what he had shot. And I'm sure each and every one of us were very pleased to be able to watch it. Now it's time to move on to our next interview and our last segment of the program. I'm going to spend a few minutes speaking with Costa McCreese from etletstalk.org. Costa's going to make a special announcement during that, so make sure you watch the whole interview. Costa, welcome to UFO Planet.
Thank you very much, Darren. Happy to be here.
Well, I'm glad to have you here, and I looked, and the last time that I had you on the program was back in June of 2013, so I'm wondering if I could get you to run through a quick overview of your program, etletstalk.org, and just tell us what it's all about.
Sure. Etletstalk.org is primarily a social community for people who are interested in having made or making ET contact. It's a safe and secure place for people to meet there and get to know each other, share their stories, and support each other. We founded etletstalk.org in November of 2012. My Toronto teammates, Lori Rosenfield and Jonathan Rosenfield, and I created it. And to this date, we have almost 5,000 users in 50 countries, or more than 50 countries, worldwide, who are making ET contact at their convenience. And
that's just since your launch last year, last fall, basically. Boy, that is phenomenal growth.
A little bit more than a year, yes. So one thing that we do in the community right now is we have monthly global ET contact events where we put teams out in the field during a 24-hour period, which is usually a Saturday near a new moon, which mm-hmm. is the dark of the sky. And we often have 200 or maybe more teams in 30 countries during that 24 hours making the contact. And what they do is they're very successful. They get interaction in many different ways, and they provide reports to us and to each other of what they've experienced in their communication with extraterrestrial intelligence. So that's a very exciting thing we've been doing on an ongoing basis. We also have a lot of other features on the website and are soon transitioning to become ufocontact.com, which will be a kind of a wider mission that includes not just the regular ET contact that we've been making and will continue to make as our core mission, but also bringing in a more general audience that we're aiming for, who's not just preaching to the choir, whom we love, but who can be educated by some of the top flight researchers in the UFO field that are going to be working with us, and others who will be partnering with us, like yourself.
Excellent. Now, Costa, just to clarify here, once UFOcontact.com is fully launched and operational, will that completely replace etletstalk.org, or will they both operate?
They will both operate. The larger umbrella is UFOcontact.com, which will be launching April 21st as our target date. All the current users and members of etletstalk.org will just be transferred their membership to UFOcontact.com. So they'll continue to be part of the ET Let's Talk community.
But
UFOContact.com, they'll have access to even a wider world that we're creating for them.
Excellent. Now, you mentioned it just briefly there about a new affiliate program that you're putting into place, and UFO Planet is going to become your first affiliate. Could you just explain what the program is?
Well, the program is a way of us sharing and partnering with others who are also in some way connected with this ET contact mission. They may be people who are like yourself, who are reporting about this ongoing contact, about the growth of the movement, or maybe people doing research at a top flight level to educate the public. There's all kinds of possibilities here for the variety of partnerships that we can build. So with an affiliate program, it's a win-win situation, because people like yourself who are doing wonderful work in your particular area can provide things that we can't, or that would take us a lot of expense and resources to build. You know, and in your case, that would be a video and audio programmatic outreach to people. So this is a meeting of equals, the affiliate program, where people who are your audience will be able to find out about us and maybe want to join our website, and people from our community worldwide at ET Let's Talk will find out about what you do and will definitely, I know, want to contribute content and material to what it is you're doing. And that's for you in specific, but for other partners, there will be ways that we can meet each other's needs, share each other's communities, and in that way, the win-win becomes a larger global movement, and everybody's benefiting, because we're all really part of a larger mission.
Exactly. We're all working towards the same goals.
Yeah.
And I just want to say that I'm very privileged to be the first affiliate with ET Let's Talk. Boy, I can't speak today. And it's funny because I can't say etletstalk.org. That's kind of ironic. And let's just touch on a little bit about memberships. Memberships come with a fee. Excuse me. And you get a lot for that membership. But what? Tell us a bit about the memberships.
Sure. We currently at etletstalk.org have what we call, you always have to name something really cutesy in marketing. So we chose the name a stellar membership and a galactic membership.
You know, excellent choices.
And it's to provide different features for people at different levels. Let me just say that as a galactic member, which is the paid membership, we kept the price astronomically low so that we could offer as much as we could for all people to be able to join us for a year. And by becoming a galactic member, they're really supporting this community and this growth, because we on the team are we're not paid. We're part-time volunteers who are giving a lot of our...
Well, let me just stop you right there for a second, Costa. You said part-time. I know better. You might call it part-time, but I know the hours that you guys are investing into this, and Lori and Jonathan and others, and there's nothing part-time about it, but it is... Sorry, just one second here. Mr. Mac decided to send me some messages. But it is a true dedication, and that membership fee goes to help support the growth of the program, correct?
Absolutely. And so for right now until April 21st, which is the launch of UFOContact.com,
I can't log into your iCloud account because your password may be incorrect.
Hang on just a second. Sorry to do that to you, but I don't know if you just heard my Mac talking to me now. Sorry, nope. I can't log into your iCloud. Either can I. That makes two of us. Sorry, if you could just carry on there again. Sorry to interrupt you.
No, it's no problem. The Galactic membership involves, right now I was saying that between now and April 21st, the launch of UFOContact.com, we're offering a 20% discount using a code called SAVE-20, SAVE-20, on our website at etletstalk.org. People can click on the membership link there. It's up in our banner at the top of the page. And just follow the easy instructions to join. Why would people want to become a Galactic member? Lots of great things. We have a community map there that shows visually the locations of all our ET contact teams all over the world.
Excellent.
And it allows the paid members to, the Galactic members, to find these people around them or far away if they want and contact them via email. That is also accompanied by the new app we're launching for Apple and Android smartphones, which is the UFO Contact app, which will allow in the palm of your hand the ability to look at this same map that I was just talking about and find these people in chat in real time.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, and in the future...
Set up a network of...
That's right. That's how we're building the network. It's the social media world, as well as there's the interactive forums where people are sharing information, supporting each other, all kind of getting to know each other, making new friends. Also, we'll be holding a retreat in Toronto, as a matter of fact, this fall, and there'll be discounts for the Galactic members as well for that retreat. The retreat will be August 28th, which is Thursday through Sunday, 28th through the 31st, and will feature a small bevy of wonderful internationally known speakers, as well as Contact Under the Stars, and a chance to be together in a community in an intimate environment in a gorgeous city, or just outside of a gorgeous city,
beautiful
as you
city.
Want, Toronto is. So there's that. We also are offering discounts to Galactic members on goods and services that we'll be providing in the future. Now, people who have the Stellar membership will have access to many of these things, but they won't be able to interact in the full fashion that the Galactic members do. We know that people value what we're doing, and some will want to be at the Stellar level, but we're really encouraging people to step up here and help support the community. We're at a time where our growth can be very explosive and good, so that we can build this worldwide community, because UFOcontact.com is going to be reaching out to a wider, more general public that is open-minded about the fact we're being visited by what they call UFOs, that we know as extraterrestrial intelligence, ETI. So they're open-minded. In the United States, 2 out of 3 Americans are open-minded about that fact, which is amazing.
That's absolutely phenomenal.
In my youth, that never happened. In the 60s and the 70s. People were just not that aware, not that interested. They ridiculed it. But now that open-mindedness means that we have an audience we can reach, and a certain number of them will want to be educated more about how to make contact, and we'll be there teaching through our seminars, through the written and video materials that we're going to provide, teaching them how to do that and helping them integrate into the community that's building, so they never feel that they have to be alone. And trust me, that's a really important thing. I'm written by people all the time saying, I'm so glad to have found this community because my can't talk about this with my family. I would be ridiculed or shunted out or something. And now I have people I can talk with. This gives many people a new lease on life, and they come with enthusiasm to the community. So
well,
we want
I think,
even more.
I think, Costa, that if we work towards the goal of making this the discovery of UFOs, of extraterrestrial intelligence and things like that, more mainstream and give it some credibility, that maybe perhaps we can take some of the edge off of it for the people who are fearful of ridicule, to give it sort of a mainstream appeal.
And it's credibility is a huge factor. And I want to mention at this point in that same vein that the addition of our newest team member, well, we have two more team members that I didn't mention who are not the original co-founders of We3, which were Lori and Jonathan and myself, but we have Dr. Joe Burks, who has an extensive background in working with contact workers, and who's going to be helping us with a lot of material about making contact and interesting, provocative articles. Also, we've just recently welcomed Daniel Sheehan, Danny Sheehan, who's a preeminent constitutional attorney who's just written a book called The People's Advocate. You can read about him on our website at etletstalk.org. Danny brings with him firsthand evidence that UFOs do exist.
A brilliant mind.
Yes, I know you know about that because you've done a program with Danny, and I know you'll be talking with him again. And you and your listeners do know that he has had some deep background and personal upfront experience with this topic, as well as a lot of knowledge about it in general, and a whole philosophical kind of spiritual structure, worldviews that he brings to this topic, which is what's leading us into the future, because the final one of his worldviews that we're all working within is humanity's contact with galactic civilizations. That's exactly where we're poised now. And the addition of Danny brings etletstalk.org and ufoplanet.com a level of credibility, knowledge, and connections that will help us to take our expanded mission further into that larger general public right now, who are on the edge of believing and wanting to do this, but they don't yet know how easy it is to make this ET contact and what they should do with it. And that's what we're here to teach them.
Absolutely. But I just want to back up just a little bit ago. I think you had a miss say there for a moment. You said UFOplanet.com when it's actually UFOcontact.com. So I just want to make sure, because you're on UFO Planet, I can understand that happening.
Yeah,
no problem,
I think
at all.
It's subconsciously giving you a plug.
Yeah, and I like that, and I appreciated that very much. Yeah. And I just wanted to make sure that my viewers understood that Daniel will be associated with both etletstalk.org and ufocontact.com. So those are some fascinating personalities that are going to be involved in your organization. And so that tends to make me believe there's going to be some fantastic benefits come for the membership of your organization. And I just want to also mention that I've been doing the program for about a year and a half now. And to this point, I have not formed any alliances or affiliations with anyone. I wanted to get to know the industry before I did that. And I just want to say that I'm very impressed and very honored to be your first affiliate and to be associated with all of you. And I look forward to having access to your organization on a regular basis on UFO Planet, to have interviews, to discuss with the leadership of your group what's going on within your organization and your future, and also with the membership that have experiences that they would like to share with the world. I think it's absolutely fantastic.
It's a perfect synergy. Everything you say and that you bring to us is going to be matched by what we can bring to you. And I think that using the visual medium right now, which is something we've been wanting to do, and partnering with you to make it possible for us to do that, will just give a whole new level of experience to your viewers and to our community. I know our community. I was just sent, for example, a video, an 8-second video today of one of our community members who caught a bright, fast-moving, shiny object moving among chemtrails.
Oh,
on video, and sent it to me. Now, that's the kind of thing that, a kind of video that once he knows about you, he'll be sending to your program, and you will be able to feature what the people in the field are doing. Because it's wonderful. We have all these eyes and ears now in the field. We're not relying anymore on governments to tell us what to think, what to believe, what's real, what's not. I mean, they're welcome to open their files and share with us.
We'd like that.
We like that. And as you know, some have done that to some degree to their credit. There are many holdbacks, though, and a lot of deep classified stuff that really, really needs to be out there. Our community, what you're doing is really a people power movement, a people's disclosure movement, where we now have the technology, we have the numbers, and we're growing more numbers of people and educating ourselves, each other, on how to make the contact ourselves and share and figure out what's going on with it. Why are we wanting to talk with these civilizations? What are they saying? What do they have to offer? Why are they here? This is very experiential, but it's very, very gratifying, because I can tell you that when people use the methods that we can teach them, they do have contact in different ways, and they get excited about it, and they want to tell their family and friends. And that's how we're growing.
And I'm looking forward to sharing that with my viewers on a regular basis. And I think, like you say, it will build that cohesiveness that we need. I've said it many times before, and I agree with you when you say that it would be great if the governments are willing to participate. And I agree, if they want to give us the information that they have, be willing to present it. But should they not, we don't need them. We can certainly do it without them now. As a matter of fact, we've seen where the social networking on the internet and things like that has actually been able to remove governments from power. So I think we, as a collective resource around the entire planet, your group working together and your membership and my viewers, and we can certainly bring out more of that information. I think the future is bright.
I think so, too. It's because it's now in our hands, and it's not someone else dictating it to us. I mean, if we can screw it up, or we can, in our own, with our own hands, build something wonderful, I think a lot of us are choosing to build something wonderful. And when we find out that it's not just us and 10 of our friends, but there are millions of others who share this belief and want a better world and want to communicate with ETI in a way that can help bring a better world, the numbers are just incredible. And people will just, and are flocking to this now. And thanks to you and what you'll be able to provide, which is an audio video outreach like this, I think it's going to happen a lot faster than it could have happened otherwise.
Well, I think that the joint effort together is going to be phenomenal, and the future is only, like you say, it's in our control 100%. Costa McCrace, a very recognized and respected person in the UFO industry from etletstalk.org and ufocontact.com. I just want to say thank you for appearing on today's program, and I'm very excited about our work together in the future.
I am too. It's going to be a great collaboration. Thank you so much for showing up and helping out and partnering with us, Darren. Welcome.
I suspect that there's going to be an awesome relationship between etletstalk.org and UFO Planet. I look forward to working with Lori, Jonathan, Costa, Daniel, and Joseph. Well, that's all I have for today. You'll kind of notice that you've got a double whammy today. The show is about twice as long as normal. That's because I will not be here on Monday. There will be no Monday program. The next date for UFO Planet will be April 17th, and we will be featuring clips from Crow 777 on that show, so make sure you tune in. I'm going to go away this weekend and to my daughter's graduation celebration from business school. So it's family time this weekend. So hopefully you don't mind too much me taking a little time off. Just want to say thanks to each and every one of you for watching UFO Planet. I appreciate it very much. I'm Darren Crapo, and I'll see you again on the next episode of UFO Planet.